Hi, I haven't done anything on this for a little bit, so I thought I would revisit it since I've been working with these plates. But this is a swag plate. It's got a strip of copper, a strip of aluminium, then it's painted with swag ink and put on a printer's block to get this alignment that we were looking at previously. So if I connect those up, incidentally it's positive to copper, negative to aluminium, and pop it in here, and what's in here is aluminium chloride solution. So if I pop it in there, I've got that incidentally on the microamp reading. It's reading because I've been doing this before. So let's put that on the milliamp reading. There we go. So that's on the milliamp reading now. And if I pop that in, then we get a couple of milliamps out of it. You can see that's going up to about 3 or 4 milliamps. That's actually better than you think, because that's about half a centimetre. It's 9 centimetres long by about half a centimetre. Oh, look at that. 6 milliamps we're getting out of that. Let's have a look at the voltage. We're getting about 0.6, 0.7 volts, something like that. That's actually quite impressive. And as I say, that's from aluminium chloride. So one big improvement in this swag was using a different salt, and here we've got aluminium chloride. The idea being that if the salt carries more of a charge, then because it's a charge separation, we're going to get more of an effect, and indeed we do. That's probably because the aluminium carries a +3. Now, it also occurred to me that something else might be happening. When you look at the swag, you can see that there are lines on it of obviously different kinds of carbon. So the magnetic field clearly does something to the constituents of the ink, and what I think it does is that the ink is made up of a diamagnetic and a magnetic carbon. And the diamagnetic carbon is pushed out and the magnetic carbon is pulled in and lined up, kind of like in rods all packed together, which is why we get those two clear distinct lines, one very black because we're looking end on, one very grey because we're looking at the plate. So we've changed the orientation of it. But like that, they're intimately mixed. So I thought it might be interesting if we could separate them out. Now obviously with that it's quite difficult because it's quite large. Sorry, it's quite small, so we want something a bit larger. So I took this, which is a neo magnet, popped it onto a plate, and got the same effect. I got a centre square that was all black, probably because it was lined up that way, and a surrounding ring that was all grey because we're looking at flat plates. Because now it's so much bigger, I was able to scrape around it to separate those two areas out and put a couple of bits of copper onto it so that I could connect to those two separately. What I've got here is copper oxide and deep eutectic solvent. The reason I'm using copper oxide, copper is a +2 ion, remember, is because we've got copper and copper and carbon, so let's use copper oxide. Looks like I've got that the wrong way around. We've put that on the microamps this time, because obviously it's tiny. So if I now dip that in and out, you get about 30 microamps. Now obviously the theory here is that the current is caused by charge separation. I've just washed that in some water incidentally. And that the charge on the ions is what has a big effect. So here we have some aluminium chloride and some deep eutectic solvent. Let's give that a go. Now we get a much higher reading. Look at this, it's tiny. I personally think it's only between the two lines that has the effect. The rest is essentially collecting the current, is what I think. Obviously, we're going to have to test that somehow. But I did this before, and it takes a little while to make one of these. I didn't repeat it. But when it's whole, we get readings of about 2 to 3 microamps. And when it's separated out like that, in the right solvent, we're getting 60 microamps. So it's an enormous impact to actually separate those out. So clearly, the next thing to do is to take this and scrape down all those lines. Look at some of the numbers on that. It gives us an approximate idea of where we are. And we're getting about 6 milliamps at about 0.6 volts from that area that we dipped in and out, giving us about 3.6 milliwatts. Now that area was around about half a centimetre by 9 centimetres, or 450 millimetres squared. So if you normalise that for a square metre, then that little experiment is producing about 8 watts per metre squared, and that's kind of cool. Now, on the second experiment, when we scraped down the lines so that we actually separated those two things out, we actually got a difference between 2 microwatts and 60 microwatts. So we get a 30-fold increase in the actual output of that thing. So if that experiment was right, and I bothered to scrape down all those lines, then we can expect somewhere around about 30 times of that, which brings us about 240 watts per square centimetre. Now, if that's right, that is impressive, because we're getting 240 watts a square centimetre is beating a solar cell. A solar cell at best is 150 watts, and we're getting 240. So I really must scrape down those edges. Unfortunately, I'm going to Sweden tonight, and I'll be there for about a week, so it's going to be a while before I can get back to this. But I think when I get back to it, I'm going to take a magnifying glass and a pin and scrape all those lines out. So and when I do that, I'll do the update for it. So watch this space.
But that is an interesting result that I thought I would share with you. So I hope you found it interesting too, and thank you very much for watching.